Hello. After my last video, I got some questions from people about doing remote work, right? So I mentioned like working with a virtual client last video. It's like, well, what does virtual work look like for you and why do you do it? And as a chiropractor, that's a fair question. I wouldn't think immediately working remotely with the chiropractor if I would have heard that. So I'll explain this to you guys because I love this question. And it starts back even in chiropractic school for me, where the core teaching in chiropractic and the traditional chiropractor is looking at the cause of disease. And it can be traced back to really three things that lead to an exhaustion, because the idea is your body's designed to heal and self-regulate. And if it's not doing that, then what's the reason? And the reason's going to come down to dysfunction physically, biochemically, or mental, emotionally. Okay, so chiropractors, especially like mainstream chiropractic, you think more about like the physical and the mechanistics of the body, particularly the spine, getting the body working appropriately so it can thrive. And I do that, and I love that. But I also love looking biochemically at the body. So that's more nutrition and environmental biochemistry, and then mental, emotional. And so I was pursuing how to help people on all those ends. What happened experientially for me when I was trying to incorporate those three aspects of the person was that when I was identifying the obstacles that were mental, emotional, or the dysfunction mentally, emotionally, that was creating the most profound healings and the biggest breakthroughs for people. So my practice went from kind of looking at the three big issues: physical, biochemical, mental, emotional. And I started focusing more on mental, emotional. And part of that was because there's other great doctors in the area that were excellent when it came to the physical, and other doctors that are really good at nutritional, like functional medicine people in the area. There wasn't a lot of people working on these subconscious issues. Because when I mean mental, I don't just mean your conscious mind, we mean subconscious. Because the subconscious is what's running all the physiology in the background, essentially driving the ship, okay? And so that gets back to being able to do virtual work. So what we're doing here is we're looking for a couple things: stuck memories and subconscious belief systems, primarily, particularly false belief systems, that are running the programming or the circuitry of your neurology to create choice, to create expectation, and of course then your neurology then also greatly affects your biochemistry and also greatly affects your physicality too. So there's kind of a trickle-down effect when it comes to what you're thinking about. And again, not just what you're consciously thinking about, okay? That's not necessarily my expertise. Mine is identifying the subconscious. And how do we do that? Well, the body understands that. So you can look at patterns in the body, or even look at patterns in your life, and you can realize, okay, what the obstacle here is, say, a stuck experience. And we can identify if that's past or if that's repetitive in your life. We can identify particular emotions just based on patterns. So we could identify something very general, like you're stuck in anger or grief or shame or guilt. And we can identify the file, so to speak. Okay, so in your subconscious mind, which you can really think is like your survival mind. Okay, this is the part of your mind that wants to keep living, and your conscious mind's a part of you that's potential to try and thrive, right? To grow as a person, to create new things, to be in relationships, to have conversations. But your subconscious wants to survive, and that's what it's going to be obsessed with. So as you're experiencing things in the world, it's downloading program from the experience, saying, this is how it works, this is who I am, this is where I fit, this is how I get love, this is how I get safety. And all those programs are useful at the time, as you're just trying to deal with negative experiences or difficult things, but they need to be updated, just like other programs like on your phone or computer. You got to update as there's opportunities for better information or more appropriate programs, or just the circumstances of your life change completely and you don't need to run that way anymore. Okay, so what's happening is our survival self, or you could say is like our protective self or our protective personality, you'd say that's your ego, is just trying to survive. So now you have this external trigger, and in my last video we talked about SEMO patterns, which is the subconscious subconscious emotional memory override, which something in your environment triggers an emotion stored in a memory, and now your system is overridden. Your physiology is no longer operating in present need, it's operating in past need, which could be like trauma physiology. But you're not running or fighting for your life. You are sitting in your car or at your desk or across the dinner table from your family or whatever, and you just got triggered, and now your physiology is like, we're not safe, and it's operating that way, which would be dysfunctional, because you could say that's not appropriate physiology for that time. So if you're across the dinner table from your family, or say your in-laws, and you're trying to eat, and you're trying to break down food, absorb nutrients, but your subconscious mind is like, we feel threatened, there's judgment here, there's shame, there's guilt, there's condemnation, whatever, and it's like, we're not safe. So now your digestion's shutting down completely, immune system shutting down completely, heart rate's going up, blood pressure's going up, midbrain is overactive, neocortex, your relaxed, restful, conceptual mind is being suppressed, healing, growth, repairs being shut down, and your body's just geared up, like, I'm ready for a fight. And then maybe that's actually what happens. You get in a fight, not a physical one, hopefully, but more mental, emotional stress. But then that reinforces the programming. So if the programming is identifying like, okay, let's just say I'm not safe, I'm not supported, which can happen as a child. You kind of get left to deal with something by yourself, and your subconscious goes, yep, this is the reality. I'm not safe, I'm not supported. I have to seek safety on my own. I have to get it. And that's fine. As a kid, you're adapting, you're trying to survive. But now as an adult, potentially there's like this family that's trying to support you, even in their own dysfunction and in their very imperfect ways. And it's like, okay, I'm perceiving a threat here, because again, you're geared towards it and you're biased towards it because you have the program. And as soon as something seems like judgment, it's like, okay, enemy, and I'm not safe. I have to go seek safety my way. And you push people away, and then their behavior starts to change too, and that's just reinforcing, like, see, I'm not being supported by them. And you further ingrain the neurology, you further ingrain the programming, so you can then go off to the next thing and say, like, yep, not supported, okay? And that's how self-sabotaging behavior comes in. And self-sabotaging behavior leads to more dysfunction, right? Because self-sabotage, kind of by definition, is choices, decisions that you make that interfere with your ability to be in a more optimized state, to be what's in you consider like health, okay? And so that's some of the stuff we work on. We're able to identify a program and open the file, so to speak. So now we get this file opened and we can look through it. This is like in a session, and it's like, okay, we're working on like this programming revolving resentment, and we have access to it subconsciously. And you're there. This isn't hypnosis, even though like it's possible to be in a hypnotized state any time of the day, but that's not really what we're trying to do here. Is we're looking at it, we're allowing the programming to come to the surface, like we're opening the file, and we're going to put new information in together, and it's very quickly. And what happens is your subconscious relearns. So we can call this neuro-emotional reprogramming. And then all of a sudden, what you're seeing in your life is you're not as able to be triggered as you were before, right? So it's like, yep, I used to, every time someone gives me a glimpse of contempt, my shame file opens up and the instructions say, this is how you behave. And that's to your body. This is how my body's going to behave. And this is how I'm going to behave, like from like a mood or personality standpoint. And that's been going on your whole life. But through this type of work, we can change the rules. We update the programs. And so it's like, instead of being like feeling contempt, shame files opened, this is how I operate. It's like, oh, I'm experiencing shame. It has no power over me. My body's not being triggered or not being hijacked. That CMO program is no longer operational. So I can behave how I want to now. I can operate how I want to. In a sense, the goal is we become more like ourselves, less like our past experiences, all right? Because your past experiences aren't you, okay? Your story is really important. Like what you've experienced, you have to make those connections so you can give yourself the appropriate like compassion and acceptance for what you've endured or what you've been through. But your story is not defining of you. You aren't your story. You've experienced it. It's a big difference, okay? Because you aren't those negative things that happened to you, okay? And if you had a very nice life, very few negative things, well, then identifying who you are based on what you've experienced then is at least very limiting. It's not you. So this type of work can allow us to see the false beliefs, the false self, the ego programming that says, like, this is how I am, this is how the world responds to me. And we can also identify truths that you've built aversions to, things that you've programmed as potentially threatening, because when you operate or you feel these things, like, bad stuff can happen. So you can make associations with things like vulnerability, for example, which is true about you. You're vulnerable and you're allowed to have intimate relationships, but in the past, something could have gone wrong, mom or dad, friend, sibling, whatever, and it's like, nope. Because when I feel vulnerable, then this potential threatening happens. So it's like, I'm going to put limitations on this experience. That could be true for creative, imaginary, even peace and joy. We can create aversions too, and we put limitations in our life on that. So this technique's also really good at identifying, like, yep, here's the aversion, here's what I need to intentionally move towards, and here's my past, and here's the things that's not me. And I may have been operating this way and trying to survive this way, but it doesn't have to happen anymore. That's part of the homework that we give in these virtual sessions is like, here's how you're going to try to operate moving forward, but we've already updated it subconsciously. So you aren't as triggered or as hijacked as you were before. You don't have to operate that way anymore. And that is it in a nutshell. So if you want to know in greater detail what we do, ask some more detailed questions or contact me directly, and I would love to hear from you. All right, bye, thanks.